Well, apparently I can't use Desmos as a legitimate graphics library for my resume, so let's talk about gaming. Nowadays, it seems like anyone can regurgitate Unity assets until they make the next Baldi's Basics, and high-level game engines such as Unity and Unreal have really made game development something that anyone can get into. Top indie games in the past few years have used even simpler engines. Game Maker Studio produced Undertale, RPG Maker produced Amori, Pygame produced... If you stretch the definition, even Discord's been used for game development, though only for very simple text-based games, of course. But game development to its full extent requires a lot of complicated engineering, from animation to mechanics, lighting, and sound. Or as they say in the game development industry, but perhaps what we take most for granted from our game engines is the ability to render in 3D. Obviously, computer screens and other devices aren't actually 3D, they're 2D surfaces. However, anything in 3D can be represented by a model, which contains a series of vertices and indices. A vertice represents a coordinate in 3D space, x, y, z, while an indice gives each vertex an index so that we don't draw duplicate vertices. We may also want to specify a mesh topology, which tells our renderer how we want to connect the vertices using these indices. For example, connecting every three vertices with a triangle. However, we should note that the vertices we now have from the model are all only relative to the model. They may tell us that the model is a cube or a character, but that's all it tells us, and it's not enough for us to create a 3D rendering. What you're going to have to do is to transform your local model through several spaces, namely the world space, the view space, and then the clip space. The world space is probably the easiest to understand if you've ever played Roblox or lived in a three-dimensional universe before. It represents the position, size, and orientation of your object in the world, and it's achieved by simply moving, scaling, and rotating your object as you want to see it in the world. View space just represents the perspective of the camera. If you want the camera to move in a certain direction, you would move everything else in the opposite direction. If you want the camera to rotate up or down, then you would move everything a certain way using some trigonometric equations. The clip space is where everything comes together, taking your 3D coordinates and projecting them as 2D coordinates on a rectangular plane in front of your camera. You can imagine there being this box that contains all the objects that you're rendering that flattens into a rectangle that you can then put onto a screen. However, if you just use a rectangular prism as your box to provide a clip space, what you're gonna get isn't going to look like real life. That's because in real life there are things called perspectives. And so you have to use a perspective projection, also known as lying, but with geometry. In real life, when things are farther away, they appear to be smaller, but a GPU has no concept of this. So what we have to do to mimic the concept is make it so that our box that holds the clip space gets smaller as it approaches the rectangular plane. This way, when an object on that part of the clip space gets projected, it appears to be bigger when it's closer, and when it's farther away, then it appears to be smaller once it shrinks down to the size of our rectangular plane. You can see that the result looks much more natural, and once you take these 2D vertexes and convert them into whatever the pixels are on your screen, you end up having your 3D render running on a 2D screen. Everything I've talked about up to now is run by a script sent to the GPU called the Vertex Shader. What this is it's basically a script that runs for every single vertice we have loaded from the model, transforms it through those spaces, and finally loads it as a 2D coordinate on your screen space. And from there, the output of your vertex shader becomes the input of the fragment shader. And by fragment shader, I mean pixel shader. And by pixel, I mean fragment. They're interchangeable. What this shader does is it takes in other data that may be included with the model, such as texture and texture coordinates to determine which part of the texture goes to which vertex, and runs for every single fragment that's been produced by the vertex shader, thus giving us color. It should be noted that this fragment shader is also sent to the GPU. And just like that, you've got a very rudimentary 3D renderer. Of course, my explanation drastically simplifies this process, and if you want to optimize your renderer or create more advanced renders, you'd have to go through many more steps, including additional shaders. I mean, I haven't even mentioned lighting, and that goes much more into simulating how light optics works. Lucky for us, there's many well-established graphics libraries that abstracts much of this process for us. OpenGL has been a standard for cross-platform graphics rendering, and its process is fairly simple to learn. DirectX offers a bit more than just the graphics rendering capabilities, and it's a bit more advanced, but it's proprietary to Microsoft, so only available on Windows and Xbox, which can be a turnoff for a certain crowd of people. Though DirectX has many versions, each one improving in performance and complexity. Vulkan also exists, I guess, and that's all I really know about it, though it's also cross-platform and said to offer higher performance and lower level. Nonetheless, we now have the tools to render 3D graphics on a 2D screen, and knowing what we know now, we could hypothetically run 3D renderings on 2D graphics tools. Of course, there are limitations to this. For example, you can't run 3D graphics on Discord. That's a text messaging app. That would be ridiculous. Well, kind of. I mean, I'm kind of cheating because I'm not using Discord as the game engine. That would be much more complicated. Instead, I'm using OpenGL, but rather than sending the outputted fragment shader data into pixels on a window, for example, I'm sending the pixels through a WebSocket to Discord API. A WebSocket is just a communications protocol that's pretty much real-time, so very useful for video games. The emoji reactions on the top message get sent through this WebSocket to our OpenGL, which then manipulates the view space if, as you remember, is the camera. Once we have moved everything as we have inputted, the fragment data creates the pixels and those are sent back through the WebSocket to Discord, where we can then render the next 20 frames as an animated file. Now, we're using animated frames rather than, say, updating an image every frame or having ASCII art, because Discord has rate limiting like any other sensible app, and so it's a lot less noticeable to have a 20 frame input lag than outputting at 1 frames per second or getting banned for API abuse. Nonetheless, a pointless animated file on a messaging app is still a 2D surface, so if anything, it still demonstrates the functionality of a 3D renderer. Though you may have noticed that there are limitations to my renderer as I used a pretty basic implementation, and thus it can only play very basic games such as Floating Cubes or Cyberpunk.